Next question comes from Ronald, and he writes, how and who established the traditional metrics that we use for valuation, and why has that changed over time? Why are different industries and businesses being evaluated with different valuation metrics versus another of traditional metrics? For example, 20 times forward earnings being cheap versus expensive for different businesses and industries.
Yeah. So, Ronald, that's a little question, and it's pretty concise.
The big answer?
The answer is a big one.
Yeah. So settle in, everybody.
Yeah. So, and this one, maybe if you guys, I don't get in trouble. I'm just a guest here. So if you guys don't like the depth that we're going into in this answer, then you can tell them and they won't have me back again, which is fine. But the short answer is some industries are inherently better than others. So that's the quick answer. Cereals, for instance, they all earn, cereal companies have earned 15% return on equity for a long period of time, and they have competing products, and that's just been a really good industry. There's other industries like airlines, typically, they've done better recently, that nobody earns great returns, with the exception of maybe Southwest or one or two airlines. So so some industries are particularly good and some are particularly bad generally. Now, the longer answer on kind of multiples and that kind of thing and valuation of stocks, and this is a more complex thought, but I think it's kind of important and it's pretty timely, is understanding the relationship between inflation rates and interest rates and bond prices and stock prices, right? And so we're kind of going to go, we'll take a little dive into that, and hopefully it's useful to you. So interest rates are driven a lot by inflation. So inflation rate, and I looked this up yesterday, is running about 2.3%. It's pretty low, and it's been modest here for quite some time. So that's the inflation rate. And what happens when banks, when they set interest rates for different loans and different things like that, they're going to have to charge above the inflation rate or they lose money, right? So, and typically, banks will charge about 3% premium to whatever inflation is. So if you see inflation's 2.3, you can expect that loans and stuff like that will be at about 5% or so. And that interest rate, in turn, influences bond rates, right? So I looked at bond rates, and we're at a weird time here, so we'll get into this back this later. I looked at T-bills. So 10-year T-bills are at about 3.14% right now. So on a $1,000 bond, you would be getting $31 a year in interest. And that's, so it's a 10-year. If you look at 30 years, you only get 3.4%. So there's not a huge premium for that extra 20 years, which is a little bit weird. We won't talk about the yield curve here. But anyhow, so those are bond rates. They're not spectacular, and they're not certainly a way to get rich right now at 3% and what you're in for T-bills. And then we look at stocks and multiples. Right now, the S&P 500 is trading just below 18 times earnings, if you look at the S&P 500. And now we compare those. Here's why it's important between stocks and bonds. Bonds are a replacement for stocks. They compete for money, right? And so if you can get 6.5% guaranteed out of a bond, you assume more risk when you buy stock, right? Because if something goes bad, Sears shareholders out there, there's nothing left for the equity holders, but the bond holders precede them, so they kind of get preferential treatment. So if you're going to take that risk for being an equity holder, you want to earn more than the bond. So as bond rates go up, then equities become less attractive. So anyhow, at 18 times earnings, when we look at the S&P 500 multiple, to compare those two, we kind of need to convert it to an earnings yield. So that's just the inverse. So if you have a PE of 10, so 1 divided by 10 would be a 10% earnings yield. We have 17.98, which turns out to be a 5% earnings yield on the S&P 500. Now, here's the interesting thing. If you buy a bond, it doesn't change, right? Like you buy that, you're going to get that coupon. That's what you get until it matures and goes to the end.
That's why I call it fixed income, because it's fixed.
It's fixed. You get no growth. But when you invest in stocks, earnings generally grow. On average, they grow about 7% a year if you look back historically. So what happens is investors typically will take a little bit less on the earnings yield for stocks than they will in comparison to bonds. Now, here's the weird thing today, which we're kind of getting at why it's important. So we have the 5.6% earnings yield for the S&P 500, and we have 3% in bonds. That's weird. Usually it would be a discount, and the discount would be if you took the rate for stocks and grew it at 7% a year, usually it's about a three-year period there. So we would expect that stocks would be cheaper. Unfortunately, they're not. You're getting more for stocks. So what does this tell us? That 5.6% tells us we should be kind of leery of investing a whole lot of money right now in bonds. And some people, Warren Buffett and others, have talked about the big bond bubble and all that kind of stuff. So as a result, I would be pretty skeptical of putting a whole lot of money in bonds today. And most of the people that have to put it in, like insurers and those kind of companies, are in very short yielding. So they're in short duration bonds. They're not going to go out there and buy that 30-year for, you know, 3.4% versus, you know, a 10-year for 3.1%. And they're probably even much shorter maturity than that. So in summary, here's what we know. Inflation impacts interest rates. Interest rates impact bond rates, and bond prices impact with stocks. So what happens when interest rates rise, and what we're seeing with the Fed right now is they're raising rates. And there's some signs that wages are growing and things like that that are kind of traditional inflationary signs. So we'd expect them to keep raising. And what happens then is bonds actually become the current prices of bonds go down when rates go up. Because if you bought a bond a day ago at a 3% and now it's 4%, well, the current bond that you have, the old bond, has to be repriced to be comparable to that 4%, so the price of it goes down. Now, if you hold it to maturity, that doesn't matter, right? You're going to get your payments and all that kind of stuff, and that's why Bro tells people to ladder into bonds and that kind of stuff. Stocks as well, when interest rates rise, the multiples generally go down. But when we look out across right now, and this is why it gets scary, and I'll wind up now for you guys, is people go, stocks look expensive to me from a historical standpoint. Well, it only has to be, you have to compare it to something. There has to be some relative comparison. And right now, stocks in comparison to bonds look very attractive.